Hello out there in Facebook land. I'm not sure if this started yet because, hello out there in Facebook land. This is Diane Simmons coming to you live from sunny Texas, where right now the weather is very cold and rainy. So this is the perfect day to have a virtual seminar because pretty much everybody's inside right now. And I expect and hope that more people will tune in soon. I have a lot of great information to share, so I'm going to jump right into it because eventually this video will be posted on YouTube. So without further ado, I will introduce myself. Like I said, I'm Diane Simmons. I am a certified personal trainer with the National Academy of Sports Medicine. I also am a senior fitness specialist and a balance and fall prevention specialist. So, and you are joining me from my Healthy Movement Concepts Facebook page, which I've had up and running for a year or two, something like that. For this little workshop, you're going to want to bring with you clean hands and feet, and if you have a Sharpie handy, and if you have a small ball or a tennis ball or a golf ball, something like that, bring any shoes that you might have questions about, and a towel. And we will use all those things later. So today we're going to cover foot anatomy, modern footwear. So we're going to do some activities. We're going to do something called the short foot exercise to strengthen the arch. We're going to talk about Morton's toe, otherwise known as Greek foot, because a lot of the Greek statuary is shows the second toe longer than the first toe. It's called Morton's foot. We will talk about five considerations when buying new shoes, and we will end with a little game that will examine some shoes and we'll see whether or not they fit the category of something that would be healthy for your feet to wear. And we will do some foot massage, self foot massage. There are some contraindications to that. So if you have a health condition for which foot massage is contraindicated, then please just watch that, but don't participate. Sorry, I have my phone on in case somebody calls about the workshop. Okay, so contraindication to foot massage would be something like diabetes or cancer, skin or fungal condition, gout, varicose vein, or viral infection. So for the self foot massage portion of this, you can just watch. I have two main sources for this workshop today. One is Dr. Emily Splickle. I was introduced to her at a virtual seminar when she was a speaker for NASM Optima back in March. I believe it was March. She is a doctor of podiatry and her office is in New York City. She's the founder of Evidence-Based Fitness Academy, or EBFA Global, the inventor of Neboso Technology, and author of Barefoot Strong. I don't have her book yet. I have read some reviews. Apparently, it's a bit more technical. There's no diagrams, and the links don't work. Probably more ideally suited to a professional. She specializes in whole body connection through deep fascia lines. And she is very technical. She uses a lot of scientific terminology, but she is a great reference. And I've learned so much through her. The other resource I have is Katie Bowman. She is a biomechanist. She's the founder of NutritiousMovement.com and author of multiple books, including Every Woman's Guide to Foot Pain Relief and Whole Body Barefoot. Very easy to understand, written in layman's terms. Even the print is large enough to read without your reading glasses. And she has another book which is on a different subject called Dynamic Aging, which also is really, really good. So a little disclaimer here. A disclaimer for this, for me, is very important when it comes especially to the feet. So I'm taking my time to read this disclaimer, and sorry, but that's just what I have to do. So I am not a medical professional. This workshop is for educational purposes only and is not intended or implied to be a substitute for professional medical advice. Always consult your healthcare provider to determine the appropriateness of this information regarding your medical condition or treatment plan. Healthy Movement Concepts and its founder claim no responsibility to any person or entity for any liability or injury caused directly or indirectly as a result of the application or interpretation of the information in this workshop. Okay, now we're going to move on. So the feet have many bones, ligaments, tendons, nerves, blood vessels, and it's really shocking just how many bones are in the feet. Each foot contains 25% of the bones in the body. So 26 bones in each foot, it's 52 bones in your feet alone. So you can see why my disclaimer was pretty important, because they are very apt to get injured if abused or used in the wrong way. So 52 bones between both feet. The foot contains 25% of all the muscles and motor nerves in your body. Each foot has 33 joints and 100 muscles, ligaments, and tendons. So that's, for both feet, 66 joints. Each toe is made to function independently, similar to the fingers on your hand. And also another tidbit of information, the arch is not one piece, but is created by the muscles and bones. The purpose of the foot is balance, loading of energy and impact forces, and propulsion. And the most important structure in the foot are the toe flexors, and their purpose is propulsion. So the toes are different than the foot. So the foot's purpose is balance, loading of energy and impact forces, and propulsion. The toe flexors is the part of the foot that is responsible for propulsion. The ligaments hold the joints of the toes together, and they're surrounded by a capsule, watertight capsule. So this is the part I wanted to get to, though. The tarsal bones in the foot, take my socks off. I'm going to be showing you my feet. So the tarsal bones in the feet are up here, and they connect to the metatarsals, which are the bases of the toes. And those, the metatarsals connect to the toes, which also are called phalanges. And so it goes from tarsal to metatarsal to phalanges. And the joint between the metatarsal and the first phalanx of the toe is called the metatarsal phalangeal joint, or MTP joint for short. So what that means is the toe is connected to the metatarsal, and the place where it connects is under the ball of your foot. All the MTP joints form the ball of the foot, and movement of those joints are very important to walking. The first toe, which I call the big toe, some people call the great toe, is the most important one in walking. It's the main means of propulsion and is in contact with the ground the longest in your gait. Unless you have a longer second toe, which is called Morton's toe, which we will address later. And although there are many small muscles in your feet, the motion, your movement is actually controlled by the muscles in your leg. So we're going to talk about how the calf muscles, the part that they play in the feet. Also, the Achilles tendon, important for walking, it attaches your calf to your heel, and tight calf muscles can cause many foot problems. So we'll do a little massage of the Achilles tendon later in the workshop, as well as the calf muscles. And I'd like this to be informal. I have never done this from my page before, so I'm not sure if anybody. Oh, hi, Leanne. I'm figuring this out as I go. I could take questions as we go or comments. This will be really good. I'm just getting through the beginning part of it. It's a little more informational in the beginning part of it. So we're saying the legs control movement, the feet control propulsion, balance, and loading of energy. But the feet are not really a separate entity from the rest of the body. They're connected through a deep fascial line all the way up the front of the body to the brain. So there is a di direct connection from the feet to the brain. And a man named Erwin Lacour, who's the creator of MoveNat, he says the healthy, efficient function of our feet is essential to the healthy, efficient movement of our body. So imagine with me a newborn baby. And this baby's the pride and joy of his parents. Right around 2 to 3 years old, the baby starts to walk. Well, before he starts to walk, the baby plays with their feet. They try to put their little toes in their mouth. And there's a lot of sensory feeling in the hands, the feet, and the mouth of the baby. So the baby starts to walk. The parents get super excited. Finally, right around age 3, the baby's walking and he gets a new pair of shoes. And the shoes are so cute, they're so little. And from the parents put them on and they're actually think that they're doing a good thing. I mean, we do what our parents done and their parents have done and their parents before them. I mean, we buy shoes for babies. So they have their first pair of shoes, and from that day on until their dying day, their feet are in shoes. Special shoes. Shoes for running, walking, shoes for religious events, for schools, for band, for parties, for rodeos, for soccer, hiking, ballet, golf, and even to wear in the home. In addition, that baby, who now becomes an adult, spends a lifetime walking on flat and unnatural surfaces. Then, when that baby is 60 or 70 years old, he or she can't walk, is a fall risk, and everybody is saying, how did this happen? What can we do? And but very few people realize this is the expected outcome of spending a lifetime with your feet in, which is a marvel of engineering. Spending a lifetime with those feet and what could essentially be considered a cast. Some shoes are like that. They're like a cast that just keeps your foot stuck in one position. But humans' feet have evolved to walk and run over a wide variety of surfaces, and that's what humans have done for thousands of years. Before shoes were invented, humans walked on dirt, sand, grass, rocks, and up and down mountains and hills, either barefoot or with leather or thinly crafted soles for protection and warmth. Then, as with many items, such as chairs and the modern toilet, having a pair of shoes became a status symbol. And it still is to this day. and their use has stifled the mobility and strength of our feet. They keep us from feeling different textures, and other sensory information is lost, like temperature and pressure. Since the 33 joints of the foot cannot move in their cast, the ankles take up the slack for mobility, and on up the kinetic chain of the body it goes. The ankles take up the slack for the lack of mobility in the foot, then the knee has to compensate for the extra work on the ankle, the hips have to compensate for the extra work on the knees, and so on and so forth. But even if we didn't wear shoes, the unnatural surfaces we walk on hardly provide any challenging or natural sensory feedback. The other day I was in the park and I had some very, very thin-soled shoes on, and I was standing on a log, and a gentleman came and we had a little discussion, and I told him what I was doing. I was exercising my feet. And he proudly said that he walked sometimes with soccer cleats on. So I didn't say anything. I just, you know, was polite and stuff. But I thought to myself, my goodness, you're outsourcing the health of your feet to a soccer cleat, which has no support and is hard and knobby on the bottom. You know, what can you do? People just don't know. If feet cannot move naturally, then the rest of the body can't. Conversely, if the feet can move naturally, then the rest of the body can. But I am not anti-shoe. Minimal footwear, which is defined as shoes that minimize the alteration of natural foot movement, is controversial. It's not safe for everyone in every situation. Likewise, conventional shoes aren't that great either. And I'm certainly not suggesting that you throw away all your shoes and walk around barefoot. But there are things that you can do to increase the mobility and strength of your feet. In this workshop, I'll show you 5 things to consider when you're buying new shoes or making a transition to minimal footwear. So, because your feet haven't needed to be mobile, your joints have kind of melded together and your ankles have taken up the slack, providing the mobility that the feet cannot. So the first thing we want to do is get our feet to be mobile again. I'm going to be doing like standing and sitting a little bit. So we're going to stand right now. And you don't need to see my feet, but just stand, and while you're standing, lift your toes, but keep the ball of your feet on the floor and just lift your toes. So your toes are separate from your feet, like your fingers are separate from your hand. And you are made to have just as much dexterity in your toes as you have in your hands. That's kind of the shocking thing. I mean, I've seen people playing the guitar with their feet and stuff like this. I always wondered, how can they do that? But actually, that's normal. That's the way we're supposed to be. So, now, if you can, when you're standing, try to lift each toe individually. I don't know about you, but that's really hard for me. I can lift the big toe. And then the other 4 all come up at the same time. I have not yet been able to isolate them. And I've been working on it for a couple of weeks, and I still can't do it. So the process is really slow, but keep at it. Remember, mobility promotes circulation. Mobility strengthens the muscles and the bones and is the information highway between the feet and the brain that keeps your nerves healthy. So if you're sitting down, what you could do, well, actually, I'm sorry, no, we're going to stand again and look at your feet and notice their symmetry. Do they look the same, or is one different than the other? Just get to know your feet. And do they point straight ahead?
Are the toes straight? Are the toes pointed straight ahead? Or do the toes point outward like this? Or do the feet pronate or supinate?
So pronate would be something like,
pronate would be an inward turning of the ankle, or supinate would be an outward turning of the ankle. Keeping the toes straight ahead puts the feet and ankles in the best position for the long-term function of all the tissues. Now you can go ahead and sit down, and we're going to do a few little exercises. So you're going to take your foot and separate the toes front and back. So you're going to be going frontward and backward with the toes. So front and back, front and back. And then stretching them out from side to side, like putting a space in between them. So front and back, and then side to side. Okay, and then do the other foot. Going to do front and back. And then side to side, stretching them out sideways so there's space in between them. Now there are things that you can do. This is a great way to start getting mobility in your feet, is to just be stretching the toes apart. And one thing that could help you is something like toe spreaders. You could put a toe spreader in between your toes. Or even, at the very least, you know, those things that they put in your feet when you do your nails. Or they have these, which is toe spreader socks. And these work really well, by the way. I like to sleep with these, and then I usually end up pulling them off in the middle of the night when I feel like my feet are saying, I've had enough. but I have no financial interest in anything that I promote here, but I'm just showing you some of the things that I use. And let's see what else. Okay, we're going to stand again. I will try to show you mine. So, there we go. All right, lift and release only the toes. So we did that already. Do it this way. And then lift all the toes, but press down only the big toe. So only the big toe will go down, but all the other four toes would stay up. Then lift all and only put the little toe down. And you could alternate, big toe down, and then little toe down. Try to do it without supinating your feet. Keep the balls of the feet on the floor, and just kind of play with that. Big toe, little toe. And then I have said in the past I have suggested to use a ball to roll under the feet. I'm going to change that a little bit. So here's where I'm going to sit down again. Dr. Emily said that aggressive foot rolling can activate the guarding reflex, which actually causes stress in the feet. So she suggested to pin and hold. And this is where we're going to use the Sharpie. Can I have a drink? Okay. So this is going to be for plantar fascial release. And there are there's several points on the bottom of the foot that will, like, they're like pressure points. So when you press them, it will help to activate plantar fascial release. And I'm only doing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm only doing 5 of them. But you can always look up Dr. Emily. She's got tons of videos on YouTube. But anyway, we start with the, in Chinese acupuncture, is called the bubbling well. It's below the second metatarsal. So it's below the ball of the foot, down the line of the second toe. And there's like a little kind of a concave spot right there. And you just hold it. So you hold it for about 30 seconds. We won't do that for, you know, that amount of time for each one of these spots, just for the time factor. But when you're doing it by yourself, you press in, and it doesn't have to be too hard. You just do it to your threshold of comfort. And then you go down to the center of the arch, and you press in there. And then you go down to just before the heel. This is the insertion of the plantar fascia, right about there. And you press that. Then you go to the outside, the middle foot. So we were here while we still have indentation. Go to the outside and press there. And then all the way over to the other side in the center, and this would be in the inside edge of the arch. Okay, so now we got to do it with the other side. So take your Sharpie and go to the bubbling well, which is below the second toe, in line with the second toe, below the ball of the foot. Hold that for a minute, and not a minute, but 30 seconds would be ideal. 30 seconds to 2 minutes actually would be ideal, but we don't have that time. And then we're going to go down to the center of the foot, and then down to just before the heel, right at the insertion point of the plantar fascia. For some people who have plantar fasciitis, it might hurt. So just make sure you're not pressing beyond a level of pain that's about 7 on a scale of 1 to 10. And then we go to the middle outside edge of the foot. And then the inside edge of the arch. Okay, good. Now we're going to stretch the top of the foot and the front of the ankle. You can do it from sitting down. So sitting down would look like this. Just take going onto the toes, the front of the toes, and relaxing into that, and feeling a stretch in the front of your ankle and the top of your foot. And then doing the other side. When you do this activity, or this stretch in particular, your foot might cramp. So cramping is very common when people do this. If your foot cramps, just give it a break, shake it out a little, wait, and then try it again. You could also do this one standing up. So if you do it standing up, you want to make sure that you keep your body in alignment. So instead of leaning forward, you're going to be leaning up. The tendency is to want to lean forward, but don't. And then the other side. body stacked vertical. Okay, good. Okay, remember what we said about tight calves? Tight calves can lead to increasing loads in the MTP joints as they try to compensate. So, tight calf will cause a compensation in the metatarsal phalangeal joint. So we want to loosen up the calves. I have two towels. I have a small towel and I have a regular bath towel. If you have extremely tight calves, start with the small one. If you're somewhat flexible, you can start with the bigger one. And you just put the front of your foot on the towel, stack yourself vertically, and stretch that leg. Again, you would want to hold this for 30 seconds to 2 minutes. And then do the other foot. Remember, stay vertical. Anytime you get a chance, try to loosen up the calves of your legs. It's one of the, it's a really great thing you could do. It's so easy. You could do it when you're on stairs. You can do it, just be creative and keep those calves flexible. Another thing you could do, this is something I really enjoy, is foam walking. It just so happens I have a piece of foam. And this is nice, it has little bumps in it. Different size bumps, so you can feel the texture with the feet, which gives it a little extra fun element. And no special way to walk, just walking back and forth. So if your ankles aren't very stable, then this is a good way to start, is with a very thin piece of foam. Once your ankles get more stability, you could go to something thicker. Like, you could take that foam and you could put it into a pillowcase and you could stand on that. So let me show you. I've got my foam rolled up. Oh, it seems like there's a glare, but it's just white foam. I'll put it down on the floor. And just kind of step on it. That feels so good. It's like a little foot massage. So that's a gradual way to start to loosen up all of the joints of your foot. Remember, you don't want to do anything fast and hard. You want to go gentle and slow as you can. And the longer you've been wearing shoes, the longer it should take. I mean, as much as a year. So before you can wear truly minimal shoes. Another thing you could do when you pass the foam, and you're ready for a little more challenge, or maybe you're already at that point and you want something more challenging, is something called a pebble tray. And I really wanted to make one for this workshop, but I just didn't have time. But you just get a tray, or like a dish pan, something big enough to fit both of your feet, and fill it up with river stone, or the kind of stones that are in aquariums. They're really, really, really smooth. And just stand on it for just a few minutes every day, as much or as little as you can tolerate, to really start to break up all of the hardened tissue in the foot and get things moving again. But like I said, gradual. If you've never done anything like this before, you wouldn't do a pebble tray for at least 6 months, okay? That's what I mean, really slow. Okay, we're going to talk about the short foot exercise. And this is a great exercise for strengthening the arch of the foot. In fact, it's one of the most powerful exercises you can do to activate your feet. But we need to know the difference between gripping the floor and grabbing the floor. So what we're going to do in the short foot exercise is we're going to grip the floor, not grab it. So for the sense of what I mean by gripping, okay, so they say these are your toes, right? Grabbing the floor would be going like this with your toes and squishing them in. I don't want you to grab the toes. I want you to grip, like that. Not grab, grip. And the way that you can feel that sensation is by leaning forward. If you just lean forward until you feel like you're about to fall, you can feel your toes kind of press into the ground. They're gripping the floor. We're not doing an activity where, you know, you're trying to pick up a towel with your foot. That would be grabbing. This would be gripping. Do you feel it's like the bottom of the nail bed, underneath the nail bed, is pressing into the floor. So that's the key sensation that you want to feel when you're doing the short foot exercise. The short foot exercise was developed by a man named Dr. Janda, and he's the same man who coined the phrase lower cross syndrome and upper cross syndrome. It integrates your deep front fascial line with feet to core connection. It also helps plantar fasciitis, and it strengthens and lifts the arch of the foot. Okay, so to center yourself, we're going to stand up again, but before I do, I want to show you the tripod of your foot. So to center yourself, you find your foot tripod. I know in some cultures it's rude to put your foot in front of somebody, so that's why I'm having a hard time with this. But just forgive me for that, and this is what I got to do. So, the foot tripod is the base of your first toe and the base of your fifth toe, your big toe and your little toe, and the center of your heel. And that would be your tripod. It's like it's a triangle. So you're going to center yourself on your foot tripod. And I'm going to put a book down. See this. All right. You have to be on a flat surface for this. So if you're on a carpet, go grab a book. And you're going to stand in what we call a bow stance. So one foot's going to be behind you, one foot's going to be in front of you. There's going to be a little space in between the legs widthwise. And you're going to, with 20% of your pressure, not maximum pressure, 20% of your pressure, you're going to press the toe, the tips of the toe. Now, when I say tip, I don't mean this part. I just mean this part, where the nail bed is and underneath the nail bed. You're going to gently, with about 20% of pressure, press that into the floor. As you do, you should see or feel the ball of your foot raise a little bit. So I don't know if you could see mine. I'm going to lift it now. Did you see my arch go up a little bit? So I'm pressing my toenail down. I'm activating the muscles in my arch. And my metatarsal, the ball of my feet, is actually coming up. I am not pressing the ball of my feet into the ground. I am not curling my toes. Now I'm relaxed. And press again. You should feel it in the arch of your foot. The ball of the feet should be coming up off the floor. It's not a huge movement, it's just a little bit. It's hardly noticeable.
Try the other foot. So the other foot is in the front, a little space between the legs widthwise, and with 20% of your pressure pressing down, and that lifts this right here. That's the first metatarsal.
If you haven't used your feet a lot in this manner, it may take a while to get the proprioceptive feedback to what you're doing. That's why looking at what you're doing is really important to make sure that you're doing it right. This should come up. If you push it down, it's moving the metatarsal head in reverse, which generates your power to move forward. So pressing down while standing still puts pressure on the sesamoids, which can lead to inflammation or fracture. The sesamoids are little bones that are nestled inside tendons in your foot. Also, pushing down on the metatarsal head, which is the ball of your feet, it's not part of the deep front fascial line. So we're not doing that. But pressing down at the nail engages your toe flexors and your plantar fascia, gets you off the ball of your foot, and increases your arch. I'm sure there's many videos on that on YouTube. Dr. Emily has a few. She says that some of the people, when they do this, they teach to press the ball of the foot into the floor. And she's very emphatic about not doing that because that can lead to injury. Okay, so then what she does, because Dr. Emily's into the whole body connection, she connects it with the breath. So pressing down through the front of the foot, at the same time, you lift your pelvic floor and exhale. Keep your tongue on your palate. Okay, so press down on the foot, number one. Lift pelvic floor, exhale, and tongue is on the palate. So, tongue on the palate. Let's go ahead and do that. Press down, exhale as you lift the pelvic floor, and then relax. And then do the other side. Press down the front part of the toes. At the same time, lift the pelvic floor and exhale, tongue on the palate. Drop the arch. That's when you would inhale. And then lift up the arch again and exhale. You can work on that. So there's YouTube videos on that with Dr. Emily. So I really recommend that. Like I said, I don't get anything in return for saying this. I just believe in it. Then what you could do is do the front foot and the back foot. And then you could do them both at the same time. Switch it up, rotate. Just remember that clawing the toes increases the reaction force under the ball of the foot. So do a grip, but not a grab. The exercises I've shown you should put you on your way to having feet that are more mobile, strong, and healthy. Next, I'll talk about things that you want to consider when you're buying shoes. The exercises and proper footwear should resolve corns, calluses, bunions, and plantar fasciitis. However, if you have been wearing low to no heels for 6 months or longer with no relief, it could be fasciosis, which is a tissue necrosis, and you need to seek medical care. There's one condition that I would like to address that is the foot type with Morton's toe. Morton's toe is the foot type where the second toe is longer than the first and third toe. It leads to pronation, which can affect the body all the way up to the shoulders and neck. And unfortunately, it is the one condition that you cannot exercise away. Remember what I said about the foot tripod? Rather than a tripod, people with Morton's toe are balancing on a knife edge that runs from the heel to the tip of the second toe. It's like a pair of ice skates, and that's why it tends to pronation or ankle instability. You must be very careful because this foot type is prone to everything from contractions to calluses, sprains, or irritation to the ligament that stabilizes that joint. When you take a step, the second MTP joint takes 2 times the body weight in everyone, but in Morton's toe is especially susceptible to tears in the plantar plate or fracture of the second metatarsal. Of all the bones in the foot, this takes the greatest amount of stress. Where normally I would say orthotics and arch supports weaken the foot's ability to intrinsically stabilize itself, if you have Morton's toe, you would benefit from a metatarsal pad behind the ball of the foot, a U-pad, taping your second and third toes together and down, or as a very, very last resort, surgery to shorten the toe. Make sure when you buy shoes to fit them to the length of the second toe, not the big toe. Let me show you a picture of the plantar plate. So this is the metatarsal. And this is the phalanx, this one phalanx. And this is the connection. Okay, right here, this is cartilage, or it's a fibrocartilaginous tissue that is susceptible in people with a longer second toe, susceptible to tear and fracture. And it is very difficult to heal. It takes 6 to 8 months for it to heal. You can't walk barefoot. In fact, barefoot walking is not recommended if you have a longer second toe. The plantar plate, so this plantar plate absorbs the compressive forces, of walking, so do not go barefoot on hard surfaces. Like I said, it's made of cartilage. Cartilage is notorious for taking a long time to heal. So we are going to, so if you have Morton's toe or not, you still need to follow these guidelines for buying shoes. So the first one, eliminate the heel. This is the most important aspect of buying shoes. A heel, any type of heel that goes up vertically in height is called a positive heel. So positive heels distort the gait and prevent full range of motion of the joints. The hips and the spine have to adjust. The higher the heel, it's like you're walking downhill and the body has to compensate. The higher the heel, the shorter the foot, the taller the body, the bigger the compensation. So remember that. The shorter the foot, the bigger the compensation. So if you have a child who's wearing a heel, their body has to compensate more than an adult would have to compensate for that same amount of heel. So keep your children in shoes that have no heel. I'll talk about the amount of height that is allowable or that is okay. The amount of heel that's okay is either negative zero, and those would be called negative heel, and that would be where the toe is actually a little bit higher, or up to 1/2 inch only. So if you're used to wearing high heels, you don't want to make that change overnight. You want to do it gradually. So say you wear 4-inch heels, so maybe go down to 3-inch heels. This is what I did, because I used to work in an office and my Achilles tendon was super short, calves were tight, and I just went gradually over a period of years back down to wearing almost a minimal heel. So go from like a 4-inch heel to a 3-inch heel, and then a 3-inch to a 2-inch over a period of months. Your feet will thank you. You will feel so much better. Trust me. Okay, so step number one, heel. Consideration number two, uppers. Anything your foot can easily slip into, your foot can easily slip out of. So an upper is the part of the shoe that keeps the shoe on your foot. So this has an upper. It's this part here. This does not. Your foot could easily slip out of this. So how do you compensate to keep this on your foot? You grip your toes to keep it on your foot. And all of a sudden, you're getting that extra pressure on your metatarsal heads. And it's not good for your feet. And not only that, the toes get strong this way and eventually get kind of stuck that way. And then when you're a senior citizen, you end up with the senior shuffle and you have the inability to let your toes move with your walking. So grabbing the shoe with your toes it changes what part of the foot pushes into the ground when you walk. So eliminate your clogs and your flip-flops. No good. Consideration number three is a wide toe box, especially for people with Morton's toe. It is very important that you have a shoe in which you can wiggle your toes. So if the toe box is too tight, it impacts the soft tissues of the forefoot and toes and can cause hook, hammer, and claw toes, and a bunch of other things too, bunions and all that. So, you know, when you talk about foot binding in China, I think a lot of the shoes that women wear now are similar in a lot of ways. So remember, have room to move your toes in your shoes. Consideration number three, and we're almost done, have a thin, flexible sole. So make sure the shoe can bend and move with your foot. This change should also be gradual. If you're used to shoes that don't bend, say for example, let's see, here's one. So a rain boot. This has no bend in it whatsoever. So if you're used to wearing shoes that have no bend in it at all, you want to go gradually from this to something a little bit softer, And then maybe someday after a year, you could maybe wear something like this. But you can't just run out and wear something so flexible if you've been in stiff shoes your whole life. So gradually. This change, flat, stiff, and sturdy shoes may be recommended by your doctor and should be worn when necessary. But to improve balance and flexibility, find a safe space to practice with a thin sole and do your exercise. So keep the shoes your doctor told you to wear And then every now and then, when you have a safe space, you know you're not going to fall. The surface is natural or easy on the feet, and you're not going to go for a long distance. Then go ahead and try to do something with a little bit more flexibility. For 6 to 8 weeks, it takes a long time. So 6 to 8 weeks before you can walk on a natural surface barefoot. The next consideration is size. Trace your barefoot, stand, not now, but stand with a piece of paper under your foot, and then have somebody trace it, or you try to trace around it, and then cut it out, and then compare it with the shoes that you have to see just how, you might be surprised, the paper cutout might be bigger than the shoes that you have. So use the traced paper to match your size shoe for the correct size. And I think I said it a few times, measure from your heel to your longest toe. So I'm not saying throw out all your shoes. I hope I made that clear. But I have a couple pairs, well, I have some pairs that, considering my personal risk level, having that wonderful Morton's toe, I really should not wear anymore. And when I do, I have a lot of pain. I don't want a fracture of my plantar plate. I want to do the thing that's right for my foot, but I love my boots. I live in Texas. I love my boots. And this is really sad for me. So, my dog keeps knocking on the door. Hold on a second. Hurry up. This is one of them. And I'm just, you know, it's okay to be sad. You know, your foot isn't as healthy as you want it to be. It's not as beautiful as you want it to be. It's, you know, age is bringing its other host of problems. And, you know, you might be losing things that you enjoyed when you were younger. And it's okay to be sad about that. And there's a Pashto saying. Pashto's from a people group from Afghanistan. There's a saying that they say, kiss and put on the ground the stone you cannot carry. So I feel your pain. I love my boots. I might keep one pair just, but really, why wear it if it's going to give me a fractured plate that takes 8 months to heal? You know what I mean? So I feel your pain. So I guess that's all I needed to say. So I wish that we could have a discussion, but I'll just go quickly through some shoes. This, so we talked about the sole, the upper, the size, the wide toe box, and the heel. So this, no, because no upper to keep it on your foot. This, flexible, has an upper, has a very low heel. Look at that. It's about half an inch. So I think this is a keeper. This will go over there. This here, flexible, but you know what? It's too small. It's not the right size. This, whoa, look at that heel. Too big. This is a small heel, but it's about an inch and a quarter, and it's too small. This is another one of those things where kiss the stone you cannot carry. If I have a nice foot insole or metatarsal pad, I'll put it in the maybe pile. All right, for all you men out there, look at this. Look, see how nicely that bends? But how big is this heel? The heel is It's about 3/4 of an inch. Not bad. I certainly can't throw away my husband's shoes. This here, nice strap to keep it on the foot. I like that. It's good size. The heel's a little bit too big, but for short amounts of time, it might be okay. This here's my son's shoe. Look at that, nice and flat all the way across. It bends. And there's no mention from her about ankle support, so I think these are good. This is a monster shoe. So I don't know what's up with the wideness of the heel, but that's an inch and a half. I don't recommend it. Look, I can't even bend it. Oh my God. I can't even bend it. My son works for an athletic company where he gets these things. And I tell him, this is no, okay. All right, this here, love my Vans. I'm sorry, I just do nice and flat across. The only thing, the sole is flexible, but it's not thin. So I would miss out on the texture of the ground. Like if I was walking across rocks or something like that, and I wanted to feel the texture of my, you know, under my feet. Otherwise, they're good. These are minimal shoes that I got for wearing around the house, and then I realized I know can do because I have that long second toe and I can't go barefoot on the tile. And this is a cute little shoe. Heel is too big. My heel days are over. I don't really miss it, to be honest. Flip flop, gone. Rain boot I'll keep, but only because I don't wear it for a long amount of time and I put an insert in it. This, I like it a lot. The sole is kind of thick, but it's real comfortable. And then a hiking boot. I hiked for like 5 hours in this a couple months ago. Super comfortable. I had an insert in it though because of Morton's toe. I kind of have to have an insert. And I'm still transitioning also, so certain shoes I have an insert. And yeah, so if you have any questions about any shoes that you have, I'd be happy to, you know, just shoot me a text or a message on Facebook, and I'd be happy to help you out. One of these books, I think it was Whole Body Barefoot, it has a list of recommended shoe companies, too many for me to get into, but she's got men's sandals, women's boots, a whole boatload of recommended reading that you can reach out to me and I can take a picture maybe and send it to you, or you can get the book. It's a super good book. So today we did the talked a little bit about anatomy and mechanics of the foot. We talked about toddler to adult use of modern footwear, exercises, some short foot exercises, the Morton's toe, and the 5 considerations when buying shoes. That was a lot. Thanks for staying with me. Leanne, the Morton's toe. The insert that I used was just something you get in the grocery store, like a Dr. Scholl's or something. It has the a little bit of arch support and a little bump that rests right behind the ball of the foot. So you can get any kind of like a metatarsal pad, which usually is kind of triangular, and you don't put it on the ball of the feet. You put it behind the ball of the foot. And if you have any questions or doubts about it, you can see your see a foot doctor. I'm sure they'd be happy to help you, maybe even without charging you. If you just say, hey, can you just show me real quick? Who knows? If they were generous, maybe they would show you exactly where. But And you can get metatarsal pads in any store. There's also, if you have hammer toe, they have, there's a splint. You could use KT tape or some kind of adhesive to connect the second and third toe and then tape it down and kind of like the, when you have the a circle and then the two ends cross. Or they make a splint for the hammer toe that will straighten it and pull it down a little bit. But I don't know if I can recommend that, not really being a foot professional. So, so that was the insert that I used, just something I got at like Walmart or HEB, Dr. Scholl's or some other. I find that Dr. Scholl's worked really well. In fact, these shoes are Dr. Scholl's. And I didn't really want to promote any business, but I guess I just did. So if there's any other question, please feel free to private message me and I'd be happy to help you. I would love to spare as many people as I can the agony of getting older with stiff and sore feet, because sore feet really stinks. No, I don't mean stinks. Sore feet can make your life really difficult. And believe me, I know. So if you enjoyed this video, please consider leaving a review on my Facebook page. Or even if you didn't enjoy it, and I'm sure there's many ways I could improve. Like I said, this was my first time doing it. If you have any comments or anything to say, please leave a review. And otherwise, thank you for joining me, and I will see some of you hopefully when COVID zone in our area gets out of the red zone. I'll plan an activity at Kikarillo that will be very interesting and fun and sensory for the feet. I have a little obstacle, not obstacle course, but something along those lines planned for when we can get out and about again. All right. Bye, y'all. Have a great day, and we will see you sometime, I hope. Bye-bye.